philosophical aesthetic, so kind of is a useful way to talk about this. And as we saw during our first meeting, there are a range of definitions of aesthetics. And part of the challenge of this class on philosophical aesthetics will be that of negotiating other fields of expert scholarship. And many questions were raised on this during our first meeting, including art appreciation, art criticism, art history, sociology of art, along with museum studies, all in addition to what may be gathered under what can also be called the philosophy of art and beauty. And sometimes there are courses given on that topic. That what's called the philosophy of art and beauty is not simply a cognate term, is indicated by this breadth. And so here we're talking about aesthetics, trying to engage that question. And if you look up on the internet or in a dictionary, aesthetics here and there, you can be struck, at least I find it intriguing, by the homonym aesthetics, which tends to refer to aestheticians, that's what they're called, hairstylists, beauticians. And indeed, there are beauty schools, aesthetic institutes, we're going to see some of those a little later, or aesthetic surgery. And there are, to be sure, and that's that slide here, where are we? Duly academic studies of these, PhD theses, and some written by MDs, so Kant, and the cosmetic surgeon published in, I think that's intriguing, the Journal of Florida Medical Association in 1989, and others. There are quite a few, in fact. In addition, ethics also plays a role, and that's something we're going to maybe come into a little bit later here and there, whenever we speak of aesthetics. So there's an ethical dimension, one can say, that also comes from Kant. And when one speaks of human enhancement, we're also, to a certain extent, speaking of the philosophy of transhumanism. Now, others in sociology and anthropology and art criticism have studied beauty schools, including cultural assumptions of beauty. And in fact, in philosophy, the phenomenologist Alfonso Lingis, who you might know because he translated Otherwise Than Being, Immanuel Levinas, writes about anthropological aesthetics, philosophical aesthetics, and ethics. Together with aesthetic style choices, and even when he was younger, including bodybuilding, but especially in connection with anthropology, where he has a great deal of acclaim, and we're going to be able to read him just a little later. In class, we mentioned, and we'll have cause to return to this as well, Naomi Wolf's The Beauty Myth. And as I pointed out then, Simone de Beauvoir's influence on Woolf's 1991 study, What Girls Learn, we emphasize that is not the desire for the other, but the desire to be desired. And that tells us about de Beauvoir. And Beauvoir herself writes on the aesthetic presuppositions of culture, of psychoanalysis, and literature. And you can see some of these presuppositions, at least I think one can, in the variation of book design, even for the same cover, not to mention the most recent and not so great translation of The Second Sex. There are also, as are everywhere, and often suppressed questions of race. Hence, in class on the first day, we referred to Brandy Summers' Race as Aesthetic, written on aesthetic practice in the precisely aesthetic industry that is Milan's fashion culture. Her article is subtitled The Politics of Vision, Visibility and Visuality in Vogue Italia's A Black Issue. We pointed out that that's much in demand. I should here add that the political philosopher Sheldon Wolin wrote a book entitled Politics and Vision, and varying the title, the emeritus professor, we'll be hearing from him a little later in the term, of political theory at the University of California in San Diego, but who now teaches at the University of Southampton. Tracy Strong authored Politics Without Vision, which touches on the relevance of vision and thereby of aesthetics a little more broadly. The tradition of aesthetics in philosophy goes back centuries. Indeed, it goes back thousands of years if one looks to the literal meaning of the Greek aesthesis and its reference to sensibility, which carries an expressly phenomenological or sense empirical connotation. We talk about the Greeks in this connection with perception, but also mimesis, as this is associated with the Platonic ideal. That is an image of Aristotle, of course, because he also talks about that a little next week. When Nicolai Hartmann, 1882 to 1950, when he died, in the introduction to a book he never finished on aesthetics, it was published posthumously in 1953, Hartmann distinguishes the artist from those who enjoy or appreciate or admire art, the enthusiasts. And we talked about that in class a bit, including the distinction between the art critic or historian. Joel Levinson, we're going to be mentioning him just a little bit later in this lecture at the moment, is still talking about this distinction, as are many, many others. Here, Hartmann, and when you read Hartmann, if you get a chance, it's posted, you might note the conventions Hartmann uses and consequently assumes in the process, just to read his very first sentence as he writes, and we quote, there's the art critic. You can tell he's an art critic because he's holding a print in his hand. One, he says, writes aesthetics neither for the creator, that means the artist, nor for the patron of the arts, but exclusively for the thinker, for whom the doings and the attitudes of both have become a puzzle. Is Hartmann himself writing for the general reader? Explicitly not. As Hartmann goes on to say, the lover of art, sunk in contemplation, can only be troubled by such thought, the artist only put in a bad mood and annoyed by it. So that's an interesting point, and we talked a little bit about that. It's possible that Hartmann might have added a more generalist introduction had he lived to see the book published. And one can say that it is evident, and it's standard in the tradition of German aesthetics, that Hartmann's book is a book on aesthetics, and his point is that, although it concerns both the artist and the spectator or the enjoyer, so both the ideal of artistic creativity and artistic contemplation, Hartmann's book is necessarily addressed to philosophers, that is, thinkers, those who wonder, using the language in the informedly scientific spirit, we see the title here, of Predrag Tikuvaki, who's written a study of Hartmann's thought, The Analysis of Wonder. We spoke a little bit about the differences between so-called continental, so this class might count as continental for some of you, and so-called analytic aesthetics in class. But the distinction, as we noted, isn't straightforward or obvious, and Hartmann may be read with profit from either approach. Still, the analysis in Sikovaki's title is, as we see, emphasizing wonder, is of the Thamazane variety, as one may note by comparing, if we get a chance to do that, Martin Morgensterns, Nicolai Hartmann, Grundlinien, eine wissenschaftlich orientierten Philosophie, basic lines or aspects of a scientifically oriented philosophy. For Hartmann, I'm going to quote, the philosopher begins where both individuals, the artist and the art enthusiast, turn over the miracle of what they're experiencing to the powers of the depths and the unconscious mass, or the unconscious. Someone probably should have translated that a little differently, I would say. But the philosopher follows up, Hartmann emphasizes, the clues left by this puzzlement. He analyzes. In the analysis, however, we're both individual, right? That's the question here. He brackets the perspective. Sorry, that slide was a little confused. In the analysis, he brackets the perspectives of devotion and vision. Aesthetics, I put that in bold for you, exists only for one taking a philosophical perspective. Now, Hartmann, among other things, is a devotee of Schelling, and a lot of people perhaps will be interested in Schelling. We're not going to read a lot of him here, but we will talk about him just briefly. And it's his day today. I mean, he's been perished for quite some time, but it's real more than 160 years, but it's really his time. Even if you look at him in terms of the times of other famous philosophers of the same epoch who had and enjoyed another celebration, it's in fact, for both of them, their sestercentennial, something to note. For Hölderlin, 20th of March, 1770 in Blaufen am Neckar, and 7th of June in 1843 in Tübingen, where he died. And that's, of course, they were born in the same 7th of August for Hegel, and a lot of people on Twitter sort of celebrated him just recently for that reason. And he died on the 14th of November, where he was teaching in Berlin in 1831. They had a triple. That's kind of a romantic notion. Today, no one seems to have triples any longer. But Schelling was the youngest of the three by considerable time. As you can see, he was born in 1775, so 5 years younger. And of course, he was the original Wunderkind, younger by that distance in time. And he lasted, as you can see from the difference here, quite a while. All of these thinkers influenced entire traditions in the case of aesthetics and art, and we're going to be talking about Hegel, and we'll even have the opportunity to, there'll be a guest, the German Reading Group is sponsoring a lecture on Hegel's aesthetics, and we'll take advantage of that as well in the class. Just a little moment before, I had been quoting from Eugene Kelly's recent translation of Hartmann's Aesthetics. And if we go back to that text a little further, as one must always read just a little further if one wants to understand a thinker, especially one who writes what, and this is his question, about what it would mean, what it is to take a philosophical perspective. So we read, viewed the other way around, this is Hartmann, the perspectives of appreciation and vision overturn, there's our thinker, the philosophical. Or, he says, at least they encroach on it. Aesthetics is a kind of knowledge. Indeed, one, this is the reference also to Kant here, with a genuine tendency to become a science. And the object of this knowledge is that attitude of appreciation and that visionary attitude the same. Not these alone are its objects, to be sure. It's focused just as much as they are upon the beautiful, but also on them. It's focused on the artist, on the beautiful, on the appreciator. So it really encompasses everything. And that's Hartmann's emphasis, and it's useful to keep that in mind. In this, he's following in the spirit of the author of the first book that uses the same book of his title. That would be, and we mentioned that already, Alexander Gottlieb Baumgarten's Aesthetica, which Baumgarten wrote in Latin and which begins, as we emphasized this already, with the same word with which Baumgarten begins his Metaphysica, namely with the prolegomena. Now, Kant criticizes the project even as, and this is worth noting, Kant later comes to contribute to it. And we're going to talk about that when we get to Kant, but it's crucial to note this here. He begins, this is Kant, with a gentle mockery of the Germans, which is always a little suspect when the author is himself a Prussian philosopher. Kant writes in the Critique of Pure Reason, the Germans are the only people who presently, and he's writing that in 1781, have come to use the word aesthetics to designate what others, he's thinking of Hume, call the critique of taste. They're doing so on the basis of a false hope conceived by that superb analyst Baumgarten. He hoped to bring our critical judging of the beautiful under rational principles and to raise the rules for such judging to the level of a lawful science. You can see how Kant emphasizes that. Yet he says that endeavor is futile, for as far as their principal sources are concerned, those supposed rules or criteria are merely empirical. Hence, this is the Critique of Pure Reason after all, they can never serve as determinate a priori laws to which our judgment of taste must conform. It's rather our judgment of taste which constitutes the proper test for the correctness of those rules or criteria. And he goes on to say, because of this, it's advisable to follow either of two alternatives. One of these is to stop using this new name, aesthetics, in the sense of critique of taste, and to reserve the name aesthetics for the doctrine of sensibility. And that's just what he does in the Critique of Pure Reason, that is true science. And so doing, we would also come closer to the language of the ancients and its meanings. And of course, his argument is that among the ancients, very nicely pointed out and also put into Roman term so that it's easier, the division of cognition into esteta, kai, no, eta, sensed or thought, was quite famous, which would mean, of course, sensed or, kai meaning and or, thought as a kind of inclusive disjunction, but actually conjunction. The other alternative, he goes on to say, but I don't have a slide for this, would be for the new aesthetics to share the name with speculative philosophy, which is what, of course, he himself is doing. You may know Baumgarten's name from your studies of Kant, and as much as Kant spent his life as a teacher teaching Baumgarten's Metaphysica, it was this Metaphysica, the standard of acquired text. Now today we're learning a little more about this notion of a standard text as we redesign, for the sake of Zoom, what decades of campus debates never induced us to do as a department, either at Fordham or at universities throughout the United States, and that would be to pick common texts to read in common. Publishers have always wanted this, just one book for philosophy classes across the nation. Hartmann's language that he uses of aesthetic perspective, Baumgartian as it is, we're going to encounter again, both in terms of perspective, it also echoes Panofsky, specifically in terms of what Kant foregrounds when he speaks of the claim to knowledge or to science, which we'll have cause to note when we get to Nietzsche. Also have another book in this tradition entitled Aesthetics, but like Baumgarten in two volumes, is by Dietrich von Hildebrandt, who formerly taught at Fordham at about the time I was born. He retired by the time I got to primary school, so I didn't have him as a colleague. Now, Sir Roger Scruton wrote the introduction to the second volume of Hildebrandt's Aesthetics, which just appeared last year. There are a range of other approaches, but we will keep to thematic and historical accounts because this is our focus here, philosophical aesthetics. But there's also a question to be raised of the art of the present day. That is contemporary art. Thus, he will be knighted, but he hasn't been knighted yet. Peter Osborne, a philosopher expert in contemporary and indeed conceptual art, reclaims and backtracks in his 2004 essay, written to remind philosophers that when it comes to art, and here Osborne, who writes in the analytic tradition, echoes, if not via direct mention so much, Dickey and Danto, it's important to return, if not to the things themselves as was so supposed, but to art as such. And so his title is Art Beyond Aesthetics. We had, let's recall, a very valuable discussion during the first meeting on the very frequently quoted, I think there was the most response to this, and that's on the level of reducing astronomy to twinkle, twinkle little star. We mentioned a chestnut in philosophical literature, fond as it is of analogy, uttered by the abstract expressionist artist, and I have a slide here, yes I do, of Barnett Newman. We saw this already, dating from a conference he participated in after finishing his well-known Via Heroicus Sublimis, you see that here, which was 1950-51. And we see in 52, just after that, he tells us, this is the intriguing thing, his claim, aesthetics is for me, like ornithology, must be for the birds. Now, if Newman himself went on to define the artist and the aestheticians as mutually exclusive terms, he thought they couldn't coincide. And it's interesting because, of course, Danto himself was an artist, and so was Richard Woodfield. And I don't know if Peter Osborne works in art, but it's also imaginable, quite conceivable that he does. This point works nonetheless as a point of departure for Nicolai Hartmann, as we already saw, and it's the inspiration for Baumgarten and Kant. So you want to keep this in mind. People get very, very sensitive about this, and so this is the point of departure for Jane Forsey. Her text is also available, and you can read that. The disenfranchisement of philosophical aesthetics, which obviously is inspired by Arthur Danto's. Here's a painting of Arthur Danto, who was a painter. The philosophical disenfranchisement of art. And that indicates a certain disquiet, as she emphasizes, and as you can also see his work as well, an essay of his, the Long Island University aesthetician, Arnold Berliant, in a retrospective account of his own writing. This is even more patent in the title of Karlheinz Lüdeking's contribution to the proceedings of the Kirchberg. You see this here, the 39th International Wittgenstein Symposium, that's in Austria. And aesthetics today, contemporary approaches to the aesthetics of nature and of the arts. Now, it's a really long title. Just what is it that makes today's art philosophy so boring and art criticism so different, so much more appealing? That's an intriguing title, but he stole it. He stole almost every word of it from a pastiche and arrangement of Richard Hamilton. It's a visual, as you see here, and 3D mashup. It's a collage. Things are painted on a photograph measuring no more. And this is important. It's really tiny, 26 by 25 centimeters. So he's not blowing anything up. He's just using magazine cutouts and pasting magazine bits onto magazine bits. So this is entitled, Just What Is It That Makes Today's Home So Different, So Appealing? This is fairly old, circa 56, you see here. I added that, so it's now another mashup, you could argue. In an age of Marie Kondo urgings towards neatness, the contrast between the two images he uses is fairly significant, as Lüdeking goes on to detail. The collage was based on an advertisement for linoleum published in the June 1955 issue of the American Ladies' Home Journal, showing an empty and quite boring suburban living room with linoleum as a floor covering. That's 76 in the Lüdeking essay, which you can find on Blackboard. There's no image here, but Lüdeking continues to explain that Hamilton glued on small pictures of modern household items, a vacuum cleaner, TV set, tape recorder, a huge can of cooked ham, a blown-up cover of a Pulp Fiction book, the heraldic emblem of the Ford car company, and not to forget, photographs of two persons who might live here, a man, and almost naked, actually, he's certainly wearing trunks, I think you can see that here. Bodybuilder sporting a huge red lollipop in front of himself, and a striptease dancer, not so disguised, with an ultra-modern hair-drying device on her head. And there's actually a lot more in the image here, so I kind of want to go back to it so that you can see. This is of course, Lüdeking's description. Outside the window, and you can see through the window here, if you go and look through there, we can see an old-fashioned movie theater announcing a film from 1927. Interesting year, Heidegger publishes Being and Time. The ceiling is replaced by the surface of some planet, presumably you see the ceiling here, that of the Earth, and the carpet has turned into a flickering pattern of black and white dots that we know from television when it's tuned to a dead channel. There's the black and white dots of the carpet that has been sort of rekeyed, if you like, and there's our can ham, and there's our lady and her hair dryer. Now, in the interim, Hamilton's, you can see the contrast, and in the article you have those illustrations very helpfully provided, but it's inspired imitations. It's easy for it to inspire imitations. So in this sort of, I can do that fashion that contemporary remix culture only exacerbates, and you have another version with Elon Musk and Angela Merkel. Lüdeking's essay is apparently, patently, very obviously an edgy discussion, and these illustrations are even more edgy, but in the same book collection that Lüdeking publishes his essay, the American analytic philosopher of music and art, and I already mentioned him, Gerald Levinson, has an essay which Levinson also publishes, and this is significant, in the same year, he has two publications of the same article in the same year, in the Journal of Aesthetics and Art Criticism, entitled Artist and Aesthete. Levinson is still reflecting on the same distinctions that Hartmann makes, without adding a reflection on the position of the making of such reflections, that is, the philosopher, as Levinson himself isn't a critic, reflecting on the difference between the creative artist and appreciative aesthete, who can also be a critic, be it approvatively or critically. And here we have Lucian Freund, who's an artist, but you can look at it in this way, and also Eugene or Evgeny Ivanov, 1926 to 1994, who was, in addition to being a cubist, also a spy. For contemporary theorists in philosophical aesthetics, some of what might be gingerly described as disquiet has found expression in the language of anti-aesthetics. So you see here a collection beyond the aesthetic and the anti-aesthetic. Now, an art is such, and it's interesting that it's the artists rather than the theorists who lead the way, this emerges in what's called realism, but can also be found in impressionism and so on. A great part of the focus is an attention to different perspectives, in particular, and one sees this in some of Vincent van Gogh's paintings, as well as others such as Jean-François Millet. And one thing to be kept in mind is, of course, that Van Gogh himself is following in that tradition. He's more famous, but he himself patterns a good deal of his work on Millet. Very nice to emphasize, with particular and particularly noted his 1857, The Gleaners, which is a question of what is the aesthetics of that? And one knows, of course, his other work. There is, and this is also exemplified in antiquity, a tremendous anti-banalistic sensibility in the arts, an aversion to labor, an aversion to the laborer, an aversion to the worker, and also to the everyday. And you can find that, and it's very obvious, especially in a French context, Van Gogh also and Millet, on the specifically Beaux-Arts, and necessary to keep the artisanal arts at a clear distance. But by the turn, that was a leftover slide, of the century, and the found or so-called ready-made art event, there was Duchamp's fountain, not to mention other artists, the movement in art is plain. In this course, the concern is going to be philosophical aesthetics, and that means it's going to include the artist's anti-aesthetic. And today, we don't really have Duchamp's events, but we do have Banksy. Thus, Danto writes, fairly in the mode of Levinson's 2017 essay, already in Danto's own 1996 From Aesthetics to Art Criticism and Back. And in class, I called attention to the ambiguity built into Barnett Newman's dismissive quip for the birds, underscoring the force of an otherwise simple analogy. And in the language of urban argot, be it in Detroit or New York, speaking of Danto, the language of to X and back carries a metonymic and filmic resonance, echoing Audie Murphy, that we have a film slide here, to hell and back. There's a difference between the aesthete and the critic, and there's a further distinction between art criticism and art history. Thus applied, art schools may feature training in criticism or curatorial work alongside training in the arts. Think of Juilliard, or think of the school for visual arts, or the Art Students League, or Institute, just over on 57th Street from Lincoln Center, down Fordham at Lincoln Center. But I should also mention, and I'd like to do that here, Bazon Brock's now defunct Denker High in Kreuzberg in Berlin. Denk am Dienst, thinker at your service. The British art theorist Richard Woodfield offers a useful discussion of the opposition between these disciplines, art history, art criticism, etc., as it's not merely a matter, as it can appear, of disciplinary opposition, although it is that, by contrasting philosophy as such, and that includes philosophical aesthetics, and art history. Thus, Woodfield draws on Max Desrat, but offers a sustained discussion of Ernst Gombrich, and takes the reader in this way, that's the title of his essay, Kunstwissenschaft versus Ästhetik, the historian's revolt against aesthetics. And although his name is listed last here, he has the first chapter in a recent book collection entitled Rediscovering Aesthetics. I quote, if aesthetics is being rediscovered by art historians, and we read this in class, it will be the second time. The first was around the year 1900. It was based on a rejection of academic philosophical aesthetics and the creation of a new aesthetics out of the materials of art history. It called itself Kunstwissenschaft, literally art science. Now, one thing here to be noted, just to the point, because it's an affair for historians and generalists alike, and it goes out if one wishes of Kenneth Clark's and his lectures on German art history, art historians and art history, as well as the dedication of the BBC, and also some central Channel 13 and so on in the US. Curatorial fascinations that are connected with class distinctions, the classist dimensions of culture. So if you want to see that further, you can either check out the talented Mr. Ripley, and that really illustrates that beautifully. It's a good film for that purpose. Or Matthew Potter's draft essay, Breaking the Shell of the Humanist Egg, which is, of course, a commentary on Kenneth Clark's University of London lectures on the German art historians. Now, Woodfield invokes Bernard Berenson, a point that retains its striking or surprising aspect, heard, and then we seem to instantly forget it. And even Nietzsche is talking about how people seem to hear it and instantly forget this, concerning the art of the ancients. And this is of course the Glyptothek in Munich, on which is one image here. But here we have, of course, wonderful holder of a diadem, that is to say, tying his head, wonderful in the museum, Metropolitan Museum of Art, and you're recommended you go and see that. But Nietzsche says these were brightly covered and clothed. This guy was not naked. This guy clearly is, but this guy was not naked. This opens up questions of race and prejudice and a number of other things, and it's on display in Frankfurt in the golden edition, as one can see, of colored deities, Bunte Götter. This is in Frankfurt right now, and it's fairly recent. You can see the mask, obviously. If we agree that the plastic monuments of late antiquity were painted and gilded, the talk of the Riegels and Wyckoffs about deliberately thought out preference for the play of light and shade and emancipation from background with the consequent abstraction of space attributed by the first to the artists of late antiquity and for the impressionism and illusionism ascribed to them by the other would turn out to be, there's Berenson here, ill-founded. You see him at the bottom checking out a painting. Actually, he looks as if he's checking out a frame of the painting. Now, the Arch of Constantine, which is that text that he's writing, shows, as other things do, that the question of philosophical aesthetics takes us back, as we're going to have cause to see again and again, not only to history and art history, questions of Kunstwissenschaft, but style and stylistics, that is also morphological questions, as these concern questions of perception as such, as well as science and knowing. This is especially the case where in the semester to come, we go back to the Greeks only to leap forward to David Hume a little later and his standards or evaluations concerning what's regarded as beyond science, beyond disputation, and that is taste. Behind this drive for classical or lasting value, one may descry an imperializing preference for the universal, and what's certain is that in the process, we overskip. This is a dangerous and habitual tendency in philosophy. Centuries intervening, one can try to do philosophy without any gaps, as is sometimes said, but it's hard to achieve in fact. University philosophy is a filigree invention of modes and fashions, and pop philosophy no less so. Hence, if for one generation, here you see, it's Will Durant, by now a forgotten name. For another, I think that's also forgotten. It's Mortimer Adler. His name is Adler. And the current candidates, there's Alain de Botton. For the Existentialist Café, other book titles I could have had, or else another title, popular, Hiking with Nietzsche, may be similarly evanescent. Styles and tastes change. Philosophical aesthetics, likewise. Thus, the effort to broaden the canon, to foreground things left out, often repeats a tendency, as when one adds new themes, there is again a choice, and exclusion is always repeated. Here, the mention of style should be helpful, as this is, as Pierre Bourdieu, and we talked about him a tiny bit in class, reminds us that taste classifies, and as he said, by the same token, it classifies, that is to say, it betrays or pigeonholes the classifier. Thus, by mentioning Alois Riegel, as Woodfield does, and as Berenson does, along with Gombrich, we are citing, even if we don't know it, Panofsky. This will do to remember Erwin Panofsky. Erwin Panofsky lived from 1892 to 1968. He was at Princeton. Beautiful and Hegelian interpretation of architecture as iconic founder of nothing less than iconology. Panofsky wrote an extraordinary book on perspective and symbolic form, a perspective as symbolic form you see here, as well as an influential smaller text. Good book to pick up if you can. It's very tiny, doesn't take up a lot of space, in the genre of a postular Gothic architecture and scholasticism, published at La Trobe, where St. Vincent's is, in Pennsylvania in 1951. Intriguingly, Panofsky's vision, complete with references to and examples from art, appear in the work of the late Jesuit philosopher and likewise former Fordham professor. Do I have a slide? I do. Space Perception and the Philosophy of Science. Helen lived from 1926 to 2015, and this book was published in 1983. Now, it's very much rather literally about that, but it's also about Cézanne, and it's also about Merleau-Ponty, and it's also about Van Gogh, and it's also about Husserl, and of course, it's also about Heisenberg. But anyway, to go back to where we started with Hartmann, and the reflection is patently a Hegelian reflection that aesthetics can say, as a matter of its principle, what beauty is, and even what its kinds and levels are, along with their general preconditions, but cannot teach in the practical sense what is beautiful or why the particular form of some construction is a beautiful one. Aesthetical reflection is in all cases post facto. So it's very Hegelian. It is in reflection is going to take its flight, as it were, at dusk. It can take its ground, the flight in this case, varying the opposite, after the acts of beholding aesthetically and simply indulging in the enjoyment of beauty has taken place. It may be that we can begin to see the point that Hartmann makes and see it as if it were to answer Barnett Newman's dismissive claim concerning the value of aesthetics for the artist, quite where art critics and theorists are often eager to tell everyone, artists included, what art is and even what art means. Hartmann makes a distinction, making distinctions, we pointed out, as the key province for philosophy, as Hannah Arendt reminds us, for its part. Aesthetics is also no continuation of art. It is not a stage above it to which art must or even could rise. Aesthetics is not such a thing any more than literature is, psychology or sculpture is anatomy. Its task is in a certain sense just the opposite. Aesthetics attempts to remove the veils from the mystery that is carefully preserved by the arts. It attempts to analyze the act of beholding that enjoys its object, which can continue as long as it isn't disrupted and disturbed by thinking. And that's why I call this a kind of Thaumatzein event, because it's disturbing to think. One is, in a certain sense, shocked by the thought. Remember Socrates as a kind of manta ray or stingray. It makes, he continues to say, into an object what is not an object in this act and cannot become one. The act itself, its reflection on reflection, in that sense, reflexivity. For that reason also, the art object is something different for aesthetics. That is, it's an object of reflection and inquiry, which it cannot be for aesthetical beholding. If you are thinking in this way, you're really not appreciating. Here, he says, is found the reason why the attitude of the aesthetician is not an aesthetical attitude, such that it naturally follows the latter. It subordinates itself to it, but does not take, in this case, very important, it does not situate or place itself within it, and a fortiori does not place itself in a position inferior to or above it. So it's neither above nor below. As already noted, in this case, it's Baumgarten's Aesthetica that is the lead. And at the same time, by giving us a series of analogies, which we saw, remember, aesthetics is to art, as psychology is to literature, or anatomy to sculpture, Hartmann asks us to look not only at experiences commonly emphasized, remember Woodfield, and he's going to emphasize, he did emphasize that from an oblique perspective, but a matter of reflection on what it is to perceive. This focus on perception, on the senses, as a kind of knowledge, was what concerned Baumgarten, as it also occupied Kant. To this same extent, Hartmann repeats Kant's analytic of beauty on imagination and the play of the powers of the mind. Thus, for Hartmann, aesthetical beholding as such isn't at stake. Rather, philosophical aesthetics is and always remains our matter of thinking. And here we need to keep Heidegger in mind, thinking the art object. Intriguingly, after a broad and careful reflection on philosophical aesthetics, including judgment, especially with respect to Kant, including the object turn, as we might call it today, Hartmann himself, like von Hildebrandt, emphasizes phenomenology. Thinking is talking with oneself, we're quoting Kant. Indeed, even Adorno emphasizes phenomenology, and there's an echo to Aristotle. This isn't quite an accidental favoring, as phenomenology is the science of appearance, what shows itself from the side of the thing as it appears as such. This is also the aesthetic. There's more on Baumgarten, as Kai Hammermeister tells us, here described as the backwards working force of any new discovery. This is the force of revolution. Previous worldviews can, in such an event, be eclipsed. At the same time, the context that we're talking about, which is essential for the understanding of past authors, can be changed by signal works, which sometimes work backwards, even if not always overnight, but sometimes via accretion. So it's worth reviewing Tom Kuhn here, The Structure of Scientific Revolutions, although this can appear to have nothing to do with aesthetics, although, of course, as a science, and a university disciplinary focus, that appearance is misleading. Indeed, it's not likely that the reference is deliberate, but the first chapter in Hammermeister's book on the German aesthetic tradition is entitled The Age of Paradigms. For Hammermeister, aesthetics, intended to be an extension of our rationalist worldview, became more and more independent until finally the rationalist metaphysics were discredited and aesthetics remained behind as a survivor. Hammermeister highlights the relevance of not Baumgarten's Aesthetica, 1750, and then the second volume in 1758, but a smaller essay, which has been available even in English for some time, more than 60 years, on poetry, a contribution to poetics, which is, as we recall from the ancients, the science of creating or making, poiesis, that's key, Meditationes Philosophicae de Nonnulus ad Poema Pertinentibus, philosophical meditations on some requirements of the poem. Note Hammermeister's gloss, especially after we just adverted to Hartmann's emphasis on aesthetics and the theory of knowledge above. So Hammermeister says, Baumgarten's aesthetics refers to a theory of sensibility as a kinesiological faculty. That is, a faculty that produces a certain type of knowledge. Aesthetics is taken very literally as a defense of the relevance of sensual perception. Philosophical aesthetics originated as advocacy of sensibility, not as a theory of art. Hammermeister offers a useful discussion of Leibniz in the course of his own subsequent reflections on pietism, and that's important in turn to understand Kant. And here too, this is going to be needed when we come to David Hume. Hammermeister cites Leibniz on art. We sometimes comprehend in a clear manner without any doubt whether a poem or a picture is well made or not, because there is an I don't know what, je ne sais quoi, that satisfies or repels us. And it would and will be useful to keep this in mind when we read Howard Kegel and his contribution to the Hume collection. Offering a gloss that can be read as a kind of negative theological aesthetics, a specialty of the era and its specialties, one could say, Hammermeister writes, and again, this will be useful for our understanding of Kant, it is a precondition for our valuation of an object as beautiful to have a merely confused idea of it and to be unable to transform it into a distinct idea. Beauty, therefore, is a byproduct of flawed human cognition. In God's mind, beauty is absent. God's cognition is instantaneous, that is, without sensible elements and thus devoid of the category of beauty. Now, if Kant initially criticizes Baumgarten. We've seen this, looked at it a little bit before, when we cited from the first edition of the first critique, that is to say, edition A. The consensus today is that Kant eventually comes over to Baumgarten's side in the Aesthetica, and in any case, he remains influential aesthetics as, here we have the slide, the theory of the liberal arts as inferior cognition, as the art of beautiful thinking, and as the art of thinking analogous to reason, is the science of sensual cognition. I'm going to end with that. And next week, when we meet, we have here the wrong slide. We'll go back to that. But when we come back, we're going to have the chance to have looked at Plato. We're going to have the chance to look at some of the Greeks and hopefully discuss questions of mimesis, of imitation, and the danger of the arts one more time, and we'll take some opinion. Thanks for that, and I hope this is of use. See you in a week's time. Bye-bye.